there's been this kind of explosion in the last 10 or 15 years of kind of new nanomaterials. All of these new forms of common materials have properties that are defined by their size. So we're kind of all about taking these well-defined building blocks and putting them together in entirely new ways.
So the center is bringing together faculty from various disciplines to build new structures, exploit new material properties. It's facilities, it's students, and of course, people with common research interests.
Fabrication at the nanoscale is especially exciting. What I'm personally interested in is the field of nanophotonics. One of the things about optics is that it enables us to send immense amount of communication bandwidths, right? We're all aware of the fiber optic network around the world. And now imagine taking all of that and being able to put it inside of a chip. So I like to say from nanoscale to exascale.
Usually when we talk about photonics, we talk about novel ways of manipulating light. Manipulate meaning control the flow of light, even the speed of light. We are collaborating with, for example, Jim Hone, who is doing the best of the best graphene, and we are integrating these novel materials with the photonic devices. So we are definitely transitioning the world of electronics to photonics, and that would completely revolutionize the way computers and data centers are done today.
And it's a much, much more energy efficient technology for moving the data. Computing is not just a thing that's sitting on your desktop, you know, with a screen. It's handheld, it's supercomputers, it's data centers, it's even something that might be embedded in your own body.
40 years ago, there were maybe 100 or 1,000 transistors on a chip. Now there are tens of billions of transistors on an integrated circuit chip. So that's really what nano really has been about for much of the 20th and 21st centuries. So what we do in my group is we sort of use that as a basis. Can you take the basic integrated circuit ideas and do more than just scaling of the basic electronics? So what we're doing here is we're really taking the chips and literally interfacing them directly with biological systems. So this involves everything from using electronics to study the properties of single molecule systems to actually implanted probes to study the brain.
Part of the beauty of nanoscience and nanotechnology is that people come at it from different angles. You can have someone who's very end goal driven. I want to make a thermoelectric material with a particular property. Can you help me using nanomaterials? Or on the more science side, where you say, no one's ever made anything assembled from these type of superatoms or two-dimensional materials. What type of properties do they have? And there's an element of prospecting.
So we are an experimental group. So what does that mean? We create something and then we have to measure different properties. We have to measure current, we measure voltage, we measure force, and we work together in a multidisciplinary group with the chemists, with theorists. For instance, recently we started to work on silicon-based molecules. And so the questions that we try to ask is, can you replace all of your silicon-based devices, which is what is in your computer, with things that are synthesized in a test tube?
The current state of the art, where our community is now, is that one can predict lots of different material properties across the entire periodic table. You can say to within a few percent that the atoms will sit this far apart, and lo and behold, that's exactly what you measure. You know, this is real exciting to be able to go and design materials virtually. And so if we can go and simulate a material, then we can ask all sorts of questions which you could never ask experimentally. It really could take us somewhere totally new.
What we do is we characterize nanomaterials. And Brookhaven has this amazing facility, which is this very intense synchrotron X-ray source. This gives us a very powerful probe of the materials. So we apply our methods very broadly. We look at pharmaceutical materials, we look at batteries, we look at high-temperature superconductors, which are very exotic electronic materials. What we're really trying to do is actually solve some quite serious societal problems. The biggest one is actually energy. So we need new sustainable sources of energy, and that's a materials problem. We would like to actually be able to even design a material. We'd like to have designer materials. Once you start thinking like that, you then you think, wow, what material would do that? But that's the direction where we're heading in.
Within the interdisciplinary research groups, there's so much that's yet to be discovered that it's a really exciting time.
It's like Darwin stepping onto the Galapagos Islands, right? You know, everything you see is going to be new.